Hello and welcome to YesterYear's Mac Games. It's Pride Month at time of recording, so I figured now was as good a time as any to look at a remarkable game for the classic Mac OS called Caper in the Castro, the earliest known LGBT plus computer game to have been made. This then is a culturally significant title which hasn't had as much coverage as I thought it might, and honestly that surprises me, particularly as the days of its inaccessibility are long gone. While considered lost for years, the game's author, CM Ralph, located some floppy disks of it and its degayed commercial stackware version during a house move in 2017. You can find a link in the video description to an article detailing how the data was retrieved from these and made available on archive sites. In the same year, Internet Archive added an in-browser emulator for the classic macOS that can run HyperCard stacks like this, okay, offering an effortless way of trying out various things running in this old engine. It is, however, not without visual oddities, and overall performance is rather low. For better results, but requiring more faff to set up, emulators such as Basilisk 2 seem to run this stack a lot better. For the most authentic experience, of course, nothing tops original hardware. The footage you're seeing here has all been recorded off of my LC2. CM Ralph was motivated to create Caper in the Castro as a way to give back to the San Francisco Bay Area community that had been so welcoming and marvellous in comparison to Southern California, where they were previously based, as well as a way to raise money for AIDS charities. Development began in 1988 using HyperCard, a unique information environment for Macintosh that was referred to as a software erection set by its creator Bill Aitkinson. TV's Computer Chronicles illustrated this with some Meccano, which I thought was quite apt. Much like how non-engineers and youngsters can use this to put together cars and cranes or whatever, non-programmers and just about anyone with an idea and some creativity could put together small apps called stacks that would then be shared on a diskette or through BBS systems. The latter is predominantly how Caper in the Castro got about. Stacks could be about all sorts. They could be newsletters, factual resources, productivity applications, stories written by users, literature sold commercially, and of course, games. A good many of these were, like Caper in the Castro, straightforward point-and-click adventures, with the player clicking through cards containing text, graphics, sound effects, and maybe some rudimentary animation. It's fairly easy to do. The cards' visuals are drag-and-drop, the menus for bestowing functionality onto the elements on screen are clear and concise, and the accompanying scripting language, HyperTalk, resembles written English. Numerous adventure or storybook stacks exist, but this wasn't all people came up with. There were arcade games, card games, other tabletop games, fighters, RPGs, it really wasn't suited for those, and even a top-down kart racer. Some of these would be sold commercially, with the initial release of Myst being a very high-profile example, but the vast majority would be put together by people in their spare time for the fun of it. CM Ralph explained that adopting HyperCard for this started as a challenge, to see what limits it had and how far they could be pushed. I've admittedly not explored HyperCard titles all that much, but from what I've seen, Caper in the Castro does strike me as one of the engine's highlights. Visuals are probably from Mac Paint, so are wonderfully typical of its era. The story and premise is gripping and consistent, in comparison to a number of other HyperCard point-and-clicks I've tried that were random and nonsensical all the way through, and it's not afraid to use a bit of humour here and there, despite being about stopping discriminatory mass murder. Silly scenes like almost drowning in a flooded restroom as a result of discharging Tracker's weapon into the toilet contrast starkly with snooping around the unseen antagonist's office and piecing together the plot to poison an entire LGBT plus community because hatred. To delve into the title's content a bit further, I reached out to my good friend Chrissy, who has a vested interest in queer game studies, to get her thoughts. So, I'll hand over now.
Caper in the Castro has the illustrious accolade of being the first LGBT plus themed video game. It was released as charityware by an openly queer developer to raise money for AIDS research to boot. As such, I've decided that, rather than analysing how the game represents queer characters, I would like to investigate how the game can be read, or rather played, queerly. So you understand where I'm going with this, let's get a bit of theory on the table. Game studies is still a relatively new field in academia, which makes sense, as obviously video games are also pretty new. Back in the day, there was a fierce debate surrounding ludology versus narratology, whether games should be examined for their game or ludic elements, or effectively treated as literature or film. To cut a long and fraught story short, it was eventually decided, why not both? Regardless of your position on this, the important thing is that games are now being treated seriously, with the same intellectual rigour as we do other cultural artifacts, such as books, music, TV and film. And rightly so. After all, the novel was once derided as stupid. Nothing more than a banal form of entertainment. Who'd say that about Steinbeck today? The main takeaway of all this, and what I'll be using in my analysis, is the idea of procedural rhetoric. Now all that just means is that the rules, structures, and systems imposed by developers on the scope of potential actions available to the player and the game's range of possible outcomes embody cultural knowledge and values. These might be deliberate ideological messages, or just the norms of the culture in which the creators live, unconsciously baked into the structure of the game. That programmatic layer of a game, which encompasses its gameplay mechanics and control scheme, as well as its systems and logic, is examined as closely as its aesthetic and narrative layers, which is what game studies used to focus on, which ignores its interactive and branching nature, the very thing that makes games unique and interesting. These layers are analysed individually and for their cumulative effect as a complete work of art. Similarly, in the even younger field of queer game studies, things have moved on. Instead of, or as well as, focusing on directly LGBT plus related content or issues in games, their industry and their culture, we now have a concept of queer reading or queer playing games. Rather than looking for gay stuff, reading a game queerly means to look for ways in which it subverts, undermines, or resists dominant or normative ideas about how to be, think, and do. When something is normative, it means that it is treated as not only natural or inevitable, but also preferable. This is how it should be. The problem with calling things normal is that it implies a negative connotation of anything or anyone who falls outside of this narrow definition. So this includes people of colour, disabled people, LGBT plus people, women, refugees, and men who aren't traditionally manly, for example in their personality or their physique. These are only the more obvious examples of marginalised qualities. For a good example of queer playing, check out Bonnie Ruberg's article on how the game Octodad, Dadliest Catch subverts heteronormative ideas of what it means to be a good father, man, and human being by having the player be complicit in his performance as successful in these aspects. She explains how the player literally plays at the protagonist passing for a normal man and keeping his true nature secret out of fear of losing those he loves, from the game's content all the way down to its purposefully unwieldy controls. Octodad's mental and physical struggles to meet societal demands speaks to many queer people's lived experience, as well as those of straight cisgendered men who don't fit that archetypal image of a real man. Hello, toxic masculinity. Reading games queerly opens up infinite possibilities. Looking at Shakespeare or Dostoevsky's works from different perspectives makes the experience of engaging with them all the more interesting, and allows us to understand ourselves and each other better. Why not do the same with those of Miyamoto or Kojima? Right, with all that in mind, let's get on with it. Upon starting the game, you are presented with its premise. You play as world-famous lesbian detective Tracker McDyke. Tracker receives a panicked phone call in the middle of the night from her friend, the renowned drag queen Tessie LaFemme. Tessie asks Tracker to meet her outside their favourite watering hole to discuss getting the goods on notorious fiend and villain Gulligan Straightman. Subtlety is overrated. When the call is ominously cut off. Of course, Tessie never shows up. Time for some sleuthing. As Tracker patrols the streets of the Castro, America's first gay neighbourhood, it's clear that times are hard around these parts. Buildings are boarded up and dilapidated. Gunshots can be heard in the distance. But, funnily enough, the gun Tracker has at her disposal can never be used violently. Its function is to gain access to locked or closed off places. The exception to this is essentially an accident. Shooting through the bathroom door in Club 102 leads to the death of the only person who can help you find Tessie, triggering a fail state, so clearly not what the game wants the player to do. If the player deliberately tries to shoot at an NPC, the game advises gently, no need for violence here. A trope of the traditionally violent noir genre being used to make a point about gun control. Now that's what I call procedural rhetoric. Another mainstay of detective fiction, binoculars, are also used for just one rather amusing and counter-normative purpose. Not scrutinising clues, but peeping at a naked woman in her bathroom. What might in another context have come across as crass or even creepy is here rendered both humorous and positive. When she notices her, the woman, holding naught but a towel, greets Tracker with a rather flirtatious "Hi." After all, this is the Castro. The two might be friends, or even lovers. The icing on the cake for me was noticing that the same audio clip is used when Tessie greets Tracker when she finds her chained up in a hidden room. "Hi." The decision to reuse this dialogue may well have been down to enable it to fit on an 800 kilobyte diskette. It reminds me of the first Silent Hill game's own hardware limitations, serving to enhance its intended effect. That infamously dense fog, implemented solely to reduce the game's draw distance, actually makes the experience all the scarier because you can't quite tell where the monsters are until they're right up close. The Tessie character is not trans, but the use of a feminine voice for a drag queen's dialogue feels appropriately respectful of her gender performance. Even what might be considered a shortcoming of the game, its lack of proofreading, takes on a resistant quality. Without wishing to be rude, there are quite a lot of typos. The in-game text was edited to make it fit for commercial release. Unfortunately, instead of making the game's text legible, as one might have expected, all queer references were unceremoniously removed from it. This included swapping out the sapphic Tracker McDyke for the cookie-cutter Tracker McDuff. These changes were requested by the distributor to protect the apparently fragile sensibilities of the computer game market's assumed straight male audience. Non-standard spellings were not omitted from this censored version, called Murder on Main Street, a suitably boring title, unlike the fun original. This decision speaks volumes about how American society, and the West at large, cares much more about erasing queer visibility than it does clarity of communication. Often, when typing in an object or location I wanted Tracker to examine more closely, I wasn't sure whether to enter the words generally accepted American spelling or the way it was presented in-game. Despite my trifling complaint, the developer minimising the number of changes made to their game to make it commercially viable clearly reflects their pride in it. It implies a desire to preserve the original work as much as possible. The presence of non-standard spellings also have a kind of DIY bedroom coding vibe. Hence be reading a counter-normative quality in it. As Tracker investigates, it becomes clear that the game is afoot. Tessie's disappearance isn't an isolated incident. She'd found out about a wider conspiracy to attack the Bay Area's LGBT plus communities by lacing bottles of alcohol to be sold in gay bars with a bacterial virus. This is being orchestrated by straight men in cahoots with the obviously Republican presidential candidate, Landon LaDouche. They've already had a police officer murdered and combusted the proprietor of a local gay apparel store by contracting an electrician to install some dodgy wiring. Their abominable plan even includes setting up several quarantine sites in the neighbouring and ultra-conservative Orange County to keep the virus from spreading outside of the gay community. This obviously resonates with contemporary players due to recent events such as the pandemic and assassinations by poisoning. However, at the time of the game's release, when AIDS was a fatal disease misrepresented as one only gay and bisexual men could catch, it would have sent chills down the spine. There are moments of queer playfulness throughout. Among my favourites is the ability to set the delightfully disgusting dish of red herring in banana sauce on fire with Tracker's lighter. The game essentially forces you to order this meal, as every other menu option has the waiters cheekily pushing you towards this daily special, or else running off to serve other customers. Indulging in culinary arson leads, quite rightly, to being chased out of the appropriately named Red Herring Cafe, because, apart from same-sex couples and eccentric food, there are no clues to be found. This kind of silliness and provision for combining odd items and actions has long been a feature of point-and-click adventures, but with a queer framing, it feels tantalisingly transgressive, largely because it serves no narrative or functional purpose. The genre revels in sometimes very odd pathways to progression, but in Caper, a lot of traditionally sensible or signposted actions in games, the kind of logic gamers are used to, result in nothing but a snarky comment or joke. The case is ultimately solved by decrypting a code that points to where the contaminated stock and our friend Tessie are being hidden. Tracker saves the day by setting it alight, killing off the virus. Congratulations, you've saved the gays! All in all, Caper and the Castro uses, and subverts, traditional conventions of the noir and point-and-click genres to tell a decidedly untraditional story. I hope you found this analysis interesting, and that it encourages you to consider how games can be read in different ways, especially as the medium is really hitting its stride with regard to technical and narrative sophistication. Game creators continue to push the envelope of what is possible, whilst games themselves have always had the power to represent the perspectives of those who don't conform to the norm, in whatever way that might be. Thanks for listening.
If you fancy taking Caper in the Castro for a spin yourself, the web browser emulation hosted on the Internet Archive can be found in the video's description, alongside the usual links to the garden and the repo for those after the game files for their own emulators and old Macs. There are a few other articles for further reading that I have also added down there which offer more information, and are well worth a look too. Big thanks to Chrissy for her contribution. Collaborating has been great fun, a first for this channel. In the spirit of the game, we've both made a donation to a local HIV and AIDS charity, and would encourage all of you to do the same. For more content on old Mac stuff, mostly games, do peruse my other videos and subscribe if you fancy catching new content as it drops. We'll leave it here then. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.